Welcome to CES 2018. The keynote will begin in approximately 15 minutes. But first, we invite you to enjoy a pre-show data entertainment experience made possible through the creative application of Intel technology. Please welcome the world's first data-only band, Algorithm and Blues.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the rest of the band.
Ladies and gentlemen, Algorithm and Blues.
Thank you, thank you. That is super fun. You guys should try that out sometime. Good evening, and welcome to Data in the Park. I'm Kevin Doucette, and I'll be your guide for this brief but extraordinary coming together of technology and entertainment. So already in this short performance, you've seen us use these gloves that sense our motion, and it's used with Intel location technology to locate our gestures in a 3D space. We activate our musical notes without any traditional instruments. And of course, it was Data that told those drones where and when to strike the keys for that entirely unique version of Chopsticks, which I hope you enjoyed. So next up, I'd like to bring a couple additional band members and pick it up a notch. So please welcome Sergio. He will be playing aero drums. Thank you, thank you. But he's playing drums without any drum kit. It's all based on and powered by aero drums, as I said, but powered by Intel Movidius. There's two little cameras there. They're going to track him in real space. But of course, the exciting part, this would not be a tech show if we didn't have artificially intelligent avatars. I'm really excited about this. So please welcome Ella on lead guitar. There she is. Thanks for joining us. And Miles on bass. So just to give you a quick preface of what's going to be going on here, this is all happening in real time. It is all live interaction. Sergio and I literally have no idea what's going to happen, but that's part of the fun of making music. So, again, I'll just reiterate, this is Intel Movidius neural compute stick, and that's what Ella and Miles will be working with to interact with me. So, why don't we try some things out, right? Hope you enjoy. Serge, why don't you give us a beat, please, and thank you. All right, Miles, let's get a bass line going. 5, 6, 7, 8. Not bad. Let's try something. I like that, Miles. Why don't we play along? Here we go. All right, Ella, why don't you join in the fun? This could be quite good. 2, 3, 4. All right. Let's check something out. 5, 6, 7, 8, 2, 3. One sec. Let's get the groove again. Ready, Ella? Here we go. 5, 6, 7, 8. This is super fun. Let's play with it for a bit. All right, how about I try and play with them both at the same time and get responses? And 5, 6, here we go. All right, next one, let's pick it up. Wouldn't it be cool, and you're probably already thinking this, if Ella and Miles can interact with each other? So of course we can do that. Let's try it out. Ready? 5, 6, 7, 8, and Miles. They're playing completely. They don't even need us anymore. What are we gonna do? You want them to play the piano? I think we could try that out. Let's try it out. Let's see if they can play this. It's all data, right? They can just play my piano, but I'd like to have it back, please. And it's more fun if we play together. So here we go. 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's break it down. All right, Ella, let's bring you back for the end. 2. I like that. Let's. Big finish. Here we go. How about that, right? Super cool. Thank you, thank you. I can't tell you how fun that is. And if there's some musicians in there in the audience, you're gonna love to be able to do this and play around in the future with that. Yes, yeah, Serge, thank you very much. So, wow, so far this evening, and we're just getting started, we've been showing you how data can be used in innovative ways to make music, my favorite thing. But one of the beautiful things about data is that same data can be used to make many, and used, sorry, in many different purposes. This is a beautiful application of data. By building the equivalent of an indoor global positioning system here in the theater, Intel engineers have made it possible for us to track the movements of a dancer or gymnast in the 3D space. So using Intel RealSense technology, powerful computers, innovative software, and these amazing Intel-based sensors, we can capture and use those streams of data to create incredible visual art in real time. Now, it gives me amazing pleasure to introduce our next little portion. This dancer will be wearing them, so keep an eye out, on her wrists and both of her ankles, and she will literally be driving the visualized data in real time. So now, please welcome 12-year-old dancing phenom, Sophie Santella.
I did my best to notice when the call came down the line. Up to the platform of surrender, I was brought, but I was kind. And sometimes I get nervous when I see an open door. Close your eyes, clear your heart. Vital. My hands are cold, and I'm
hear it for Data Rocks the Park. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This evening's keynote will begin in just a moment.
Just a young gun with a quick fuse. I was dreaming of bigger things. I was lightning before the thunder.
Thunder, 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 thunder,
thunder, thunder, thunder, thunder, thunder,
thunder,
thunder, feel the thunder. Lightning and the thunder. Thunder, feel the thunder. Lightning and the thunder, thunder.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome President and CEO of the Consumer Technology Association, Gary Shapiro.
Thank you. It is my greatest pleasure to introduce tonight's keynote speaker, Intel CEO Brian Krzanich. Now, you know, Brian is no stranger at all to the CES stage. In fact, those of you who have experienced one of his several keynotes over the last few years already know what to expect. An insightful look into the future of technology and delivered in epic style. And I do mean epic. As you already saw from tonight's amazing pre-show experience that proves data can rock. Brian was named Chief Executive Officer of Intel in May of 2013 after serving a variety of technical and leadership roles in manufacturing and as the company's chief operating officer. Under Brian's leadership, Intel has undergone a fundamental transformation from a PC-centric company to a data-centric company. It's expanding into markets like memory, modems, and programmable solutions while bringing investment and innovation to emerging areas like artificial intelligence, virtual reality, 5G, and self-driving. Together, these company-wide efforts have aligned Intel around an array of opportunities driven by a single factor, the explosion of data, something I'm certain we'll be hearing more about tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Brian Krzenich.
Good evening. So today is a day where we all come together to celebrate the lifeblood of our amazing industry. And that's really about innovation. But before we start, I want to take a moment to thank the industry for coming together for another purpose: to address the recent security research findings reported as Meltdown and Spectre. And the collaboration among so many companies to address this industry-wide issue across several different processor architectures has been truly remarkable. Security is job number one for Intel and our industry. So the primary focus of our decisions and discussions have been to keep our customers' data safe. As of now, we have not received any information that these exploits have been used to obtain customer data. And we're working tirelessly on these issues to ensure it stays that way. The best thing you can do to make sure your data remains safe is to apply any updates from your operating system vendor and system manufacturer as soon as they become available. For our processors and products introduced in the past 5 years, Intel expects to issue updates for more than 90% of them within a week, and the remaining by the end of January. We believe the performance impact of these updates is highly workload dependent. And as a result, we expect some workloads may have a larger impact than others. So we'll continue working with the industry to minimize the impact on those workloads over time. When we come together like this, there are endless possibilities. And I'd like to share some of those possibilities now with you. So if you'll indulge me, I'd love nothing more than to simply put my phone away and to take this evening to truly celebrate innovation with you. So welcome to CES 2018. I'd like to focus tonight on a resource that is already transforming our world. And I predict that it will continue to transform the world in dramatic ways over the coming decades. Unlike sand, water, or precious minerals, this resource has no limits. In fact, it's expanding exponentially. And the resource I'm talking about is data. And it's the unseen driving force behind the next great wave of the technology revolution. In fact, I think it's even bigger. Data is going to introduce social and economic changes that we only see perhaps once or twice in a century. And in the 19th century, we saw this change with the combustion engine. That led to the rise of the automobile, which ushered in the modern transportation system of trains, cars, and planes. 50 years ago, we saw another inflection point with the creation of the integrated circuit and the rise of the semiconductor industry. And this is the story of Moore's Law, which has shaped every aspect of modern technology. And we need to think about data changing our society in the same way. Data will redefine how we experience life in our work, at home, in school, even how we enjoy sports and entertainment. It's going to make possible experiences that no one has even started to imagine. I think the time has come for us to entirely think about the importance of data differently. Now, the breakthrough came from computing power. Computing has become so fast and so powerful that we can now generate and capture information capable of prediction, decision-making, recognition, and even thinking. So what do we mean by data? Let's start with some basics. Almost everything we associate with technology generates data. Any device with a plug, every email, every podcast, every picture you post on Instagram, and even the blog you're writing about this keynote tonight. All of it creates and shares an incredible amount of data, and it's all connected. And today, the cloud is filled with billions of bytes of data going from our devices to the data center and back again. We've created literally a flood of data. It's really staggering. By 2020, the average person will generate 1.5 gigabytes of data per day, which is about 2x what a person creates today. But that's small in comparison to an autonomous car, which will generate about 4 terabytes of data per day, or 2,500 times the amount of data a person will generate. A connected airplane will generate about 40 terabytes a day, and a smart factory will generate 1 petabyte of data, 1 petabyte of data per day, and that's the equivalent of 700,000 people. And that data is moving all around us at an unimaginable speed. That speed allows the device in your hands to make decisions in an instant. And this is a big shift in how edge devices provide value. There was a time when data was something that was stored and processed and very carefully shared. And some businesses would analyze that data, and that led to some pretty interesting insights. But basically, data was a static commodity. But all that shifted in just the last few years. Today, data is the foundation of innovation. Almost everything you'll see here at CES, virtual reality, smart cities, autonomous driving, and above all, artificial intelligence, they all start with data. And people have been writing about artificial intelligence since the 1950s. But what we're seeing emerge today is a rush of breakthroughs using data and AI. And this includes facial recognitions, device controlled with voice commands, robots, autonomous vehicles, and even art itself. And for example, the work of Refik Anadol, an artist who teaches at UCLA. What you can see are images from his installation called Winds of Istanbul. And what Refik does is he takes data from the wind, wind speed, direction, gust patterns at 20-second intervals throughout the entire year. And as you can see, what he does is he uses that data to create these images. Data, in other words, has become the source of art. And where else can we apply the power of data and AI? And I think we're just beginning to push the envelope here. Intel is working with the NASA Frontier Development Lab to use AI to advance the exploration of space. And data plays a critical role. We can now combine imagery from millions of images collected by NASA missions with powerful deep learning to transform that data into detailed surveys of the rocky terrain of planets and moons in our solar system. And using this collected data with artificial intelligence, we can automate the creation of valuable maps. These maps are required for autonomous rovers to navigate the rough terrain. And this provides valuable information as well for future missions. But in the years ahead, we'll be able to crowdsource that data from information collected from scientists all over the world. And they'll help us advance our efforts to further explore deep space. Art and space are just two examples of how data is going to reshape our world. Devices operated by voice commands, visual intelligence, precision medicine. I spent my whole life watching technology make dramatic leaps forward. And the advances in data and AI we'll see in the coming years will dwarf all of that. And if you're impressed by what you see today, well, stay tuned. We're still discovering new ways to apply the power of artificial intelligence and data. And these discoveries will impact nearly every sector, and that is what is meant to reimagine data. As some of you know, every time I come to CES, I like to show technology that will impact the future. In fact, I'm going to show you how we're using the power of data to transform some of the most exciting areas of human activity. So let's begin with our view of an incredible data-driven experience that we call immersive media. Now, data has moved far beyond what we'll call technical calculation and computation. It's become a life force of creativity. And one of the most exciting non-traditional uses of data is its role in the creation of this immersive media. It's going to transform the consumer experience in almost every area: retail, travel, advertising, entertainment, education, even medicine. But the real opportunity is to use data to produce and deliver the most immersive, realistic content possible. And this was the missing piece. You're going to see here this week a lot of great hardware products on the market that enable the VR experience. But without the most compelling content, those devices will never live up to their potential. We realize that creating and delivering this content could only be done by solving a massive computing problem. And that's exactly what we do at Intel. And I want to show you how we use our expertise to deliver this immersive media tonight. And this breakthrough combines artificial intelligence, advanced camera technology, and millions of HD images to blur the lines between reality and imagination to create something known as volumetric video. So now let me give you some insight into how this all works, because it comes in a variety of flavors. Within Intel, for instance, we have several different technologies that enable the creation of immersive experiences. One of those technologies is Intel TrueVR, which is already making an impact in sports globally and will continue to transform fan experiences. It also extends beyond sports and will increasingly affect how consumers will interact with the content in all kinds of experiences. With TrueVR, we place multiple cameras along one side or around the perimeter of a playing field, or even on a downhill ski run. Each of these cameras has multiple lenses that allow us to have 180 to 360 degree stereoscopic view. But there's much more to creating this high quality virtual reality experience than just those cameras. When the output of these individual cameras are stitched together with sophisticated software and powerful computers, it allows a fan to not only use their headset to look around the field, but also choose the camera position they want. The result is having the ability to select the best seat in the house at any time. And that's what TrueVR gives the viewer. Now, we also have a technology that some of you may know by the name of 3D. We are now calling this Intel TrueView. And this technology takes a very different approach. To deliver this experience, TrueView involves the installation of dozens of high-definition 5K resolution cameras positioned around the entire viewing area. This allows us to define the 3D space and volume of the area inside the camera ring by dividing it into billions and billions of data points that we call voxels. Okay, so what is a voxel exactly? Well, think of it as a pixel that's placed in three-dimensional space that adds depth to the content you're capturing. And before you ask the question, why are we going to talk about voxels tonight, I'd ask you to remember that just a few years ago, not many people outside of technology really knew what a pixel was either. Today, everyone uses the word pixel. It's to describe the quality of a television or a computer screen. It's really become part of our everyday speech. And a voxel takes this just one step further and adds depth and volume to give us volumetric video and content. Everything inside that cube is data, and it's captured. However, there's a big difference between these two forms of digital information. When you capture the data that makes up the billions of voxels in a large-scale action scene, like a quarterback throwing a pass downfield, you're no longer recording just a point of view of one or two cameras. You're recording everything. The result redefines an immersive experience. By recording a scene this way, we effectively have the ability to take the viewer inside the 3D space of the scene from any angle he or she wants. The result redefines what an immersive experience is. And by recording a scene this way, we effectively have, oh, it didn't skip. There it goes. This is more than just a different way of filming and capturing the action. The technology allows you to deliver an entirely new type of experience, giving viewers more choices than they've ever had before. Now, of course, it takes a tremendous amount of computing power to do this. The setups we've created to deliver TrueView for the National Football League, they produce data at the rate of 3 terabytes per minute. 3 terabytes. That means we're creating the data equivalent of all of the text in the Library of Congress in the first quarter of any football game. So it's not a simple matter to create this experience. As you've seen, the results are stunning, and we're just getting started. We're incredibly excited to explore all of this technology can offer across a broad range of immersive applications. Over the last year, we've introduced the world to this immersive way to experience sports through a variety of partnerships with sports leagues and teams worldwide.
The promise of the immersive media technology is it transports you into an experience as if you were there.
We're incredibly excited about the potential for immersive media to bring our fans closer to the game than ever before. We've got fans all over the world that just want to get as close to the action as they can. And I really think that this could be the way they do that and one of the primary ways that they watch our sport in the future.
The goal here in an immersive experience is to give people choice. It's to give them the ability to decide what they want to see, when they want to see. I think it's going to give people that aren't always able to make it to an event an opportunity to actually experience what it's like being at the event, not just viewing the event.
The immersive media allows you to experience virtually everything that you would in the arena. But we combine that with our broadcast to continue to provide editorial, to continue to provide context, to allow you to move around the arena so you're not just stuck in one place in the arena, but you have choice and you can choose from sitting courtside to sitting up in the bleachers to sitting on a bench.
with Intel's technology, I think there's a great opportunity to tell that story. There's a great opportunity to use technology to show different perspectives, to show what a player is thinking or maybe seeing when they execute a play. And I think those things are really unique and bring something new and richer to the experience.
The broadcast technology has to bring us to a more entertainment event, more than a sport event, a more entertaining event for all publics. Today, we are using a lot immersive media technologies, not only in our transmissions, but also in our social media.
The power of data is going to be useful in creating context around an immersive experience. It'll enable people to have a choice about what they want to see and what they want to do when they're in the experience. So it's really about creating an experience that's not just something that you're passively watching.
The first time I experienced virtual reality, I was in an office here at the NFL. I put on the headset and all of a sudden I was standing in a corner end zone. A receiver caught a touchdown pass, ran towards me, and I physically felt the need to move out of the way. I then heard the crowd behind me. I then physically turned around to look at the crowd. And I think that was the moment that made me realize that this was something different.
So we aspire to deliver this same value we're bringing to the sports leagues that you just saw to the biggest athletic event on the planet, the Olympic Games. 1 month from today marks the beginning of one of the most exciting global sporting events, the Olympic Winter Games in Pyeongchang, South Korea. And Intel is helping to reimagine the Olympic Games so all spectator moments that happen in Pyeongchang become unforgettable experiences for people all over the world. From taking entertainment to new heights with a synchronized drone show, to seeing the future of connectivity with the largest 5G demonstration at the Olympic Park, to transforming how the world watches sports with the first Olympic Winter Games broadcast live in virtual reality. Intel is integrating innovative technology to ensure fans don't just witness the moment, they experience it. Our vision is to allow viewers the chance to experience the thrill of downhill skiing, ice skating, snowboarding, as if they're actually there. And this immersive experience is best with a VR headset. But for tonight, we've retrofitted the room here with a screen to give you the same view as virtual reality. So let's give it a try. So we really feel a special anticipation for these Olympic Games because our teams have been on the ground preparing to bring these amazing moments to life with our Intel TrueVR solution. And together with the International Olympic Committee and the Olympic Broadcasting Services, we'll deliver the largest ever VR experience with a total of 30 events, both live and on demand. This is an incredibly ambitious undertaking, so we can give viewers the opportunity to experience the games in an entirely new way. I'd like you to take a quick look behind the scenes at how we'll do it.
It's clear that fans across the globe love the Olympics. There's no doubt about that. I think what's interesting now is that you've got fans who want to engage in the content, the passion, the athleticism, in new ways, in different ways.
So maybe I want to watch half pipe from under or beside or left or right, or I want to see what they look like when they're preparing for that jump, and I have the freedom to choose that camera angle.
For the 2018 games, we're going to bring a level of virtual reality experiences that are frankly unprecedented for the games. So we are going to do 30 independent events, about half live, about half video on demand, and bring those to fans literally across the globe.
And VR isn't just 360 degree video, it isn't just 180 degree video, but it also is this ability to choose your camera angle. It's really truly experiencing it. And that is a giant difference to be able to put somebody in the venue.
So we're covering super fast sliding events from bobsled and luge to events like figure skating, from downhill skiing to cross country and biathlon. Events that require a different approach to production and different approaches to the technology to allow for those experiences to happen.
The basic process that we have is we put cameras on the field, it captures content, and then on the back end, we stitch all these images that come out of these lenses together, and then we make them consumable to end users.
So Intel is very uniquely positioned to bring about this revolution in sports, all the way from capturing the bits and bytes out on the field to processing enormous amounts of data in real time and packaging them in a form that can be shipped tens of thousands of miles across the world.
We've got a slew of technologies at Intel: volumetric video, virtual reality, computer vision, analytics. The only thing that people want to care about is, are you bringing me a fantastic experience? And so it's our job to weave these technologies together in a way that delivers an experience that people say, how did they do that? And I want more.
So, Intel's working with the rights-holding broadcasters worldwide to provide audiences at home this new immersive viewing experience. And in the US here, we're working with NBC Olympics to deliver the Olympic Games in virtual reality to fans through the NBC Sports VR app. And you can go to your favorite app store and download that. So this technology will give family and friends the chance to see athletes compete as if they were truly attending in person. But you can get a sneak peek of this experience right here at CES. At our booth this week, you can actually experience the virtual reality technology we'll be using at the Olympics. And I invite you to stop by the booth anytime and try it out. So another innovative area where data is making an impact is in esports. Esports is the fastest growing spectator sport in the world, with over 400 million viewers. These athletes push the boundaries of performance and require the best tools to compete at the highest levels. Generation Intel Core is the standard for incredible performance and the most intense gaming experiences. As the competition is produced live, Intel Xeon processors convert the video into a single stream so that fans at home won't miss a moment of the action. Now, if you've ever witnessed one of these, I highly encourage you to go out and check it out. The esports competition has set truly a new standard for gaming. And something unique this year, in 2018, for the first time, a standalone esports tournament will be played with StarCraft II leading up to the Olympic Games. You can turn it on Twitch, on the finals, on February 5th. Well, the power of data is influencing a variety of events beyond the Olympics and esports. And Ferrari is another place. Ferrari is one of the most iconic names in motorsports and sets a high standard for racing. And I'm excited to announce that Intel has partnered with Ferrari of North America to bring the power of artificial intelligence to the Ferrari Challenge, a championship race series that takes place at 6 courses around North America. Intel AI enables event detection and object recognition to allow fans to experience the event like never before and see the drama of the race unfold. And during a 30-minute race, over 4 terabytes of data will have been generated from a single video stream. And additionally, producing a live broadcast requires the power of an Intel Xeon processor to identify objects and events, transcode them, and stream them. During this same race, Intel AI will create an additional 1 terabyte of identified data that can provide insights for drivers to further hone their skills and enhance their training. There's one more place I'd like to look at where you'll see data and sports come together, and that's in the National Football League. Intel and the NFL have been exploring ways to provide fans with more immersive ways of enjoying the sport. And as the technology advances, we're going to explore a variety of opportunities to create an immersive experiences that are tailored to the individual viewing habits. I'd like to invite Chuck here on stage to give us a look at just what this technology is able to do. So, hey, Chuck, welcome to CES. And maybe you could tell us a little bit about what you've got here.
Absolutely. So, you know, Brian, I'm a huge sports fan.
Yep,
so
I know that.
What happens on a typical day, there's all these sports I want to watch, but I don't have enough time to watch them all. Whether it's football, baseball, basketball, or during the Olympics, all those events that are happening concurrently. So I have to pick one event and then hopefully catch up on all the rest of the events later on in the night. But wouldn't it be awesome if I could pick that event, but then have all the things I was interested in show up in that event? Right? That'd be awesome.
That'd be nirvana.
Right? So let me take you into a glimpse of the future, show you what watching sports would be like if we had multiple data streams. So I invite you and your audience to join me in my VR headset. I'm headed to Arrowhead Stadium. I'm going to watch the Kansas City Chiefs take on the LA Chargers. So now I put on the game here. Now the first thing you're going to notice, you have this game on the giant screen above you. Right now it's 195 foot and you can see the entire field. But you also see a little blue square, and that's actually the view I have in my headset. Now, if you're watching this at home on your HD screen, you'd have almost that exact same view. But look at all the data that's outside that little blue square. I mean, all that data has to be constantly updated and refreshed, so when I move my headset, I have a seamless view of the field. Now, when I'm watching the game at home, I'm typically always going to my tablet or my phone to check out my fantasy football team. But because I've got multiple data streams here, I've actually taken my entire fantasy football team and brought them into this game. So if you look on the far left-hand side of your screen, you'll see my entire fantasy football roster. And you can see how easy it is for me to look at them, see what their scores are, and how they're doing. Now, if they've got a green circle on them, that means they're on the field and they could score at any second. But if that circle is flashing, that means they had a huge bump in their fantasy points. And it looks like, well, I've got two players. One of them, Marquise Goodwin, actually has the Intel TrueView logo next to him. So that means there's a highlight video, but not a 2D highlight video, but one of those amazing 360-degree videos that Brian was telling you earlier. So let's head to the San Francisco 49er game where they're taking on the LA Rams and check out the highlight. Now you can see Marquise Goodwin, he's on the left-hand side of the field. He's streaking down, he's in double coverage, but look how he uses his body to separate the player, the defender from the ball, uses a tremendous leaping ability, and makes a very athletic catch. Now, it was catches like this that made me fall in love with the NFL as a kid. But now with technology like Intel TrueView, I can actually see that detail and so much more and appreciate the athleticism to the next degree. Now I'm back in the game. You can see I've got another score, Kareem Hunt, 31 points today. My fantasy team is going off.
It's a great example of how we're going to transform fantasy football and sports in general. Thanks a lot, Chuck.
Thanks, Brian.
Okay, so what if we wanted to take it a bit further? Not just watch the sports from the bleachers or the sidelines or even the best seat in the house, like Chuck just demonstrated, but what if we wanted to be right there in the middle of the game? Earlier, we talked about our technology, Intel TrueView, that creates that volumetric video and those voxels. This is the magic needed to make you feel like you're right on the field with your favorite players, or even see through their eyes, allowing you to be the player. With this technology, watching sports will never be the same. So let's take a look at a clip from the LA Chargers versus the New England Patriots, a game where we will become Tom Brady. Sorry. You'll see. So what you see here is that we're able to see right through Tom Brady and see what he sees on the field. That's a different perspective. That's a perspective that nobody else can provide you. There's not a camera in his helmet. There's not another system showing that. That's going inside one of those voxels and looking out from outside his helmet. To give us an outside-in perspective of this technology, we wanted to find somebody who has experienced this point of view from the field and analyzed plays in the booth. And we couldn't find anyone better to talk about these, be the player highlights, than the former Dallas Cowboys quarterback and current NFL broadcaster on CBS, the real Tony Romo. Hey, Tony, so first, sorry, but welcome to CES.
No, people get me mixed up with Tom Brady all the time. So, no problem.
I know the feeling. So, as a professional football player and now an NFL broadcaster, you know, you've had a chance to see the TrueView technology firsthand. So, can you tell us a little bit about your experience with it?
Well, I think the first time you ever see it, when I saw it and we used it on air, it kind of wows you. The first time you're kind of blown away because your whole life you're kind of watching this 2D version of television. And then all of a sudden you look at the screen and you're like, whoa, this is different. And you don't even know you're looking at this 3D thing that's 360 degrees. And, you know, I told Brian earlier, I was like, who's the guy that's got that camera that's just, you know, controlling this thing that's moving around so much? And then you kind of get into the detail of it and it's really revolutionary what they've done and pretty special.
So, okay, that's great. That's how it kind of feels. So maybe if we could play a clip we captured from one of the games this season, and I'd like you to walk us through it and just kind of tell me your thoughts about what it's like to both be on the field and see what they see out there.
Well, in this play, you're going to see Joe Flacco from the Ravens, and he's got, as you can tell, the pocket where he's looking. He's got a cornerback right there in his vision, and he's got the safety. He's got to fit this ball right in there. Don't throw this, Joe. Don't throw. Oh, touchdown. Good job, Joe. But you know what? There's not any other technology that would show you how tight this throw was and how difficult it was for Joe. This allowed you as a viewer to really go right there and be Joe Flacco, and you could be like, I can't believe he's making this throw. There's no window there. You get to appreciate the ability of that guy at that moment. At the same time, you'll be able to go back and nitpick and be like, not a good job, Joe, if you had thrown it to the other guy.
Luckily, that was a good example there. So, so, you know, what are your thoughts about how using this true VR and VR technologies is going to impact the future of the game for both the fans and the broadcasters?
Well, I think the future is now with what's happening. I think what you guys are doing, you can see it. It's already there. Just the ability for you guys are compressing all this data, the terabytes and terabytes, and you're instantaneously putting it on broadcast. No one's doing that. And that's why it's just something that you can just see with your eye. Right away, you're like, whoa, I like this. You don't know why, but you're like, I like this. My brain tells me, the sensory, it's pretty special and unique. And then for me, the specialness comes from being the player, getting right in there with that Joe Flacco. You want to be the middle linebacker, you get to see him go in and make the tackle. It can zoom in as if you are a camera on the helmet of that player. And nothing else can do that without putting a camera on someone's head. And that's why I think you're going to feel like you're back playing football again for some of the people, you know, who would have made it to the NFL, but you had that knee injury.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you'd have been there.
There's a lot of those at CES. There's a lot of those at CES. Trust me.
Well, I mean, I'd still be playing if I would have had that.
So thanks a lot, Tony, for coming here tonight and really giving us the perspective of both the broadcaster and the player. I really appreciate it. I look forward to seeing you call some of the playoff games here on CBS. Thank you.
Thanks, Brad. Appreciate it.
I didn't tell you about that knee surgery I had, right? Now that I've shown you how this technology can be used in sports, I want to take you to another way that it can be applied, many more creative applications. What we learned from bringing together data and sports is that data is going to redefine how we create experiences for all audiences in the future, not just sports. And that's why we've built an Intel Studio, the most advanced data-driven production studio ever created. The same TrueView technology you saw for the Be the Player clips is being used to revolutionize entertainment. And this incredible technology is changing the way we think about filmmaking and content creation. So let's take a look at our journey from an empty warehouse in LA to a studio that's leading the way to the future of media, we believe.
In a history that has spanned more than a century, the technology behind the making of motion pictures has seen only a few innovations that could be considered truly transformational. And it all started with the work of a pioneering photographer by the name of Edward Muybridge, who performed a simple experiment often regarded as the single most important event in cinematic history, the horse in motion. This iconic set of 24 photos was shot in rapid succession by a lineup of 12 individual cameras and played back on another Muybridge innovation known as the zoopraxiscope in order to create the illusion of movement. In other words, one of the world's first motion pictures. Fast forward approximately 150 years, and another such transformational moment is about to take place. Here, inside an unassuming soundstage near Los Angeles International Airport, the next great innovation in motion picture entertainment has been under construction for more than a year. 25,000 square feet of total studio space, a 10,000 square foot volumetric capture area, 5.1 miles of fiber, 10 petabytes of on-site storage, and a nearly unfathomable amount of compute power. This is Intel Studios, the world's largest and most advanced volumetric video capture and creation facility. Designed to harness the power of data in new ways by capturing motion performance in three dimensions and via more than 1 billion points of light, the scale and scope of what the studio makes possible represents the next great transformation in the art and craft of producing motion pictures, offering an entirely new way to create more fully immersive and interactive experiences, even ones as challenging and iconic as a horse in motion.
So today I've got a special treat for you. We just finished that studio back in fall, and I'd like to show you our debut clip of the first volumetric capture, featuring really a classic Western action scene with a horse, of course, in motion. But before I give you the volumetric view, what I'd like to do is show you what the scene looks like from a single point of view from a single camera, a traditional display. So let's roll the first single camera. And what you can see, it's the Western scene. They're fighting. The hero breaks free, gets on the horse, and rides away. And that's pretty much the traditional view of a movie. And what that is we just took one of those 100 cameras and captured just that video and displayed it for you here. Now, I want to show you that same scene, the exact same scene, captured volumetrically. So instead of the one camera, we just combined all 100 and the petabytes of data that it took to go produce this. It's a fantastic example, we believe, of what's possible when we bring this new era of data to the world of filmmaking. So let's take a look at that volumetric version. A little bit different, huh? Which movie do you want to watch? So this is still a work in progress. As I said, we just finished this in the fall. It's still being refined. And we really believe this is a new beginning to a new kind of content production, one that you'll be able to see in a variety of viewing ways, virtual reality, traditional. Now, the important thing to remember is that we shot this scene only one time. And now we have all that data and the ability to recreate the scene from any point of view. You could walk through it at any point and just look around. You could see it from the outside. You could spin the camera around as we did in other directions. You could be an observer looking through one of those windows. Or you could be the actor yourself. And we chose to just take it a next step and show you a non-traditional actor. So we chose to give you the view from the horse. Here we go. So you always wondered what it was like to be a horse, right? It's not that important that it's the horse here. The amazing thing about this technology is that you can do the scene and then you can look at it from any perspective. And there's going to be non-traditional perspectives that are going to give us a completely different view and different interpretation of a scene. And that's the real flexibility that creators will have in the future. And this is a new standard of entertainment and technology that we believe is going to help the most innovative content creators in the world to rethink the movie experience of the future. And this is today. It's real. So today I'd like to announce an exploratory partnership with Paramount Pictures. And to tell us a little bit more about how we are revolutionizing media, is Paramount Pictures Chairman and CEO, Jim Giannopoulos.
Hi.
Hi, Jim. So, welcome to CES. Thanks for being here. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
Maybe you could, we're really excited about exploring this partnership together. Maybe you could tell us a little bit about what excites you about the changes you're making and how immersive and volumetric video fit into your strategy for Paramount.
Sure, well, Paramount's a storied institution with a great legacy, and we're privileged to have creative relationships with some of the most talented and acclaimed filmmakers in the world, storytellers that have truly achieved great achievements. And so combining that with our executive teams, and especially with advancements like this volumetric technology you showed, the future is really bright. So we're very excited about it.
So let's think about the next decade. What type of experiences do you think you could envision for viewers looking at a technology like this and that creative talent you have?
Well, the advances in cinema have come from seeking out new frontiers. And so partnering with Intel on this type of technology is a key to our future. You see, the technology you've developed is an impressive step in the creation of a new form of entertainment, and we think audiences are going to embrace this new generational experience. So, you know, your video highlighted the evolution of the cinematic experience from silence to sound, from black and white to color, and then on to 3D and other technologies. All of those were advancements in giving the audience a new way to see entertainment closer to the way we experience the real world. And so virtual and augmented reality are the next level. And as audiences are moving from a flat screen to an immersive experience, we'll be able to convey the world and the cinematic setting and the storytelling setting in a way closer to reality than cinema has ever been able to do before.
So for the movie watching experience of the future, you know, what type of movies do you think you'll see using this volumetric video?
Well, I think you're going to see some remarkable filmmaking. When you give filmmakers tools like this, their imagination is unfettered, and you get some of the most gifted and talented filmmakers in the world. You can only imagine what talent like that could do with this technology. And so with Intel's help, we'll be taking advantage of the latest creative and technological tools to put our audiences literally inside the movie experience and give them a vision of the future of entertainment like never before. That's very exciting.
Yeah, Jim, I just want to thank you for coming here to CES and this partnership. And I, you know, for us technologists, we can't wait to hand this over to the creative people that you bring.
It'll be our pleasure. Thank you, Brian. Take care.
So we're really at the early stage of this technology, and we think that soon we'll be able to merge it with the real world and the virtual world together. And that means we'll be able to capture scenes in which the viewer feels like they're part of the action. And they'll actually be able to move and control their own experiences. Imagine you being able to watch a movie and pick the character you want to be. That's going to be a whole new experience. Now, this isn't limited to movies, but extends to television, advertising, music, gaming, and so much more we haven't even begun to imagine. This type of immersive experience will become the new normal as incredible amounts of content is created and audiences engage with this new innovative type of media. Now, to understand one direction it's going, I thought let's take a look at the experiences we can create with Sansar. And Sansar takes the digital environment that was first introduced with Second Life and refreshes it with an entirely new virtual reality look. And we worked with Linden Labs to create a visual and sound experience that completely bridges the real and virtual worlds. And I want to give you a firsthand look at this experience. So I'd like to invite Diana on stage here and tell us a little bit about what you've got here with Sansar.
Hi, Brian. So we have an amazing immersive experience that's designed just for CES. Would you like to take a look?
I would love to.
All right. Well, first we need to accessorize. Let me give you this HTC VR headset.
No cables.
No cables, thanks to Intel's Y-Gig technology. So if you'd like to put that on and follow me backstage, and we will enter the virtual world.
Okay. I recognize this. It's the Intel CES booth.
Yes, it is. This is a sneak peek for you and the audience before the show floor opens tomorrow. For those here at CES, you can visit us at the Las Vegas Convention Center in person. But for those who aren't in Las Vegas, we've created a virtual model of our CES booth inside Sansar. Just visit intel.com to get access.
Hi, Brian. Thanks for inviting me to preview the Intel CES booth.
Hey, welcome, Gary. Glad you could join us here.
This virtual booth is great. The show covers so much these days, sometimes it's hard to see everything I want. And being able to visit virtually offers a great alternative for people who can't travel to Las Vegas.
Exactly. It's a live, social VR experience where visitors can see and talk with Intel booth staff and other people visiting from all over the world.
What's actually inside this booth?
We have all kinds of amazing experiences that show how data powers autonomous driving, artificial intelligence, 5G, and more. Visitors can also learn more about our new 8th Gen Core processor family and how it is the foundation for creating immersive experiences like this one in Sansar. And there are even booth staff available to answer questions.
Hi there, I'm Lisa. I'm here to answer questions about our virtual booth.
Hi, Lisa. So are you in the physical booth in Las Vegas?
I'm actually in California. I'm really looking forward to meeting virtual visitors from around the world. One thing I know they'll like is a spotlight theater, where they can watch all the presentations happening live from Las Vegas. Many of the demos represented are interactive, and you'll want to keep an eye out for some special bonus experiences that are only available here in VR.
I'm really glad that we're offering a way for everyone, anywhere, to visit our booth at CES.
This is a great way to extend CES to more people. Thanks so much for inviting me to visit. And now I'm looking forward to seeing the rest of your keynote.
Thanks, Gary. Thanks, Lisa. See you guys later.
Before you go back to the keynote, Brian, I want to show you one last thing.
Hey, this is a poster for Steven Spielberg's upcoming movie, Ready Player One.
Exactly. As you know, Ready Player One takes place in the future when humans spend more of their time immersed in a virtual reality world called the Oasis. This poster is actually a portal to a virtual recreation of one of the sets from Ready Player One, H's Garage. Want to take a sneak peek?
Wow. Okay, this looks amazing. Is this the footage from the movie?
No. What you're seeing here is a virtual space we built with HTC and Sansar. It is a virtual recreation of the original set that Warner Brothers designed for the movie. It took us a little less than 6 weeks to build this out using our latest X-Series Intel Core processors and Intel Optane memory technology.
This is incredible. When can I explore it more?
You'll get a chance starting tomorrow. Anyone visiting Intel's booth here in Las Vegas, or virtually, will get a chance to look all around H's Garage.
Great, and I can't wait to see Ready Player One when it comes to theaters on March 30th. Thanks for the virtual tour of the booth, Diana, but I should probably get back and continue my keynote.
Okay, just head that way to the stage. I think I'll stay here a while. See ya.
Thanks, Diana.
That was absolutely amazing to put together an experience in virtual reality. And it's clear that the future of entertainment is built with imagination and creativity and, again, enormous amounts of data. And data is the foundation of innovation, and of course, it's impossible to talk about data without thinking about the future of computing itself. And this is something we've been tackling at Intel since our earliest days. Tonight at CES, I want to give you a preview of where computing will go next. One of the fascinating developments is the rise of neuromorphic computing. We've been building something that truly mimics the way that the brain observes, learns, and understands. Our research efforts have produced a prototype chip called Loihi. To understand more, let's hear from some of our team that has been working on it.
Traditional computing rests on this basic idea of you have two computing elements, a CPU and a memory. And neuromorphic computing is throwing that out and starting from a completely different point on the architectural spectrum.
Our own brains are remarkable in what they can do. We're simply trying to learn from what our brains, the brains of animals, can do to make systems that are smarter and more efficient.
And what we're looking for is to connect all of the neurons in the chip much like we would with an actual brain. So neuromorphic computing is basically the concept that we're going to simulate the brain in silicon.
Neuromorphic computing will show up where they find an application that benefits from being able to embed the intelligence into a device, initially in areas of robotics, autonomous vehicles, where the power and the size and the adaptability are really beneficial.
There's a number of different ways it can go, and we can see it filling out the whole extent of machine learning as people have envisioned. So it's a generalization of computer architecture to really provide the right tool to implement artificial intelligence.
What Luigi provides is just like your brain, it's going to connect up neurons to get together. And the way your brain learns is it changes the connectivity between your neurons. What Luigi gives you is the capability to build a network, and then you feed in data, and then it will change the network as you're going and learning, and then we'll tell you what the result is online, at the edge, in low power.
It's really fun to be a part of a project where we have the strength of a company like Intel to invest in these areas and to really solve these hard problems with the whole portfolio of great technology and talent. And neuromorphic computing is an extremely hard problem, but it's one that Intel's scale and expertise can really be brought to bear and make a real difference in the industry and for the world.
So as you just heard, neuromorphic computing has the potential to change the way devices understand and interpret data. But of course, that doesn't happen automatically. And these devices have to be trained with data in the same way that the brain learns something new for the first time. This has been a major research effort at Intel, and today we have a fully functioning neuromorphic research chip. Our Loihi research chip is the most advanced neuromorphic chip yet developed, and after only a few weeks, it's already performing simple object recognition in the labs. This incredible technology is going to influence future products and innovations. And in the years ahead, Intel will put Loihi in the hands of our research partners to unleash the true potential of our prototype. We're really optimistic about what this new kind of computing can achieve over time. I'd like to take another leap in computing, though, and this time make it a quantum leap. And let's talk about quantum computing for a second. And quantum computing represents an entirely different approach to computing. This technology will be able to solve problems that are insurmountable today. Quantum computers are composed of quantum bits, or you often hear the term qubits. They use massively parallel processing to solve problems that today the best supercomputers will take months or even years to resolve. So what can you do with all this computing power? Well, one possibility is you could model chemical molecular interactions for drug development. And this often requires testing endless combinations of molecules to find the right solutions. And with quantum computing, this process is dramatically accelerated. This is just one example of how we're thinking about quantum computing today. Just as we ushered in the era of our classical personal computing, we're pushing the boundaries of the quantum computing revolution. Our labs and researchers are committed to these innovations, and we see it as a fundamental scientific and engineering challenge. Now, we've been working with the leading QTech labs at Delft University in the Netherlands to test and build full quantum computing systems. And you've probably heard us talk about our 7 and 17 qubit systems. Well, today, I'm proud to show you the next step. I'm proud to introduce to you our 49-qubit quantum chip. This 49-qubit chip pushes beyond our ability to simulate and is a step towards quantum supremacy, a point at which quantum computers far and away surpass the world's best supercomputers. We expect to solve key technical challenges that must be overcome to move quantum computing forward. There's quite a bit more work required than just this chip, but this is a major breakthrough in quantum computing. We're going to continue innovating in this space to tackle life-changing complex problems and believe the most impact will be in things like material science and the discovery of new materials such as superconductors and new molecules to advance pharmaceuticals. The future of both neuromorphic and quantum computing are coming much faster than anyone imagined. And I'm confident that they'll transform our lives for the better. The next generation of computing will be more than about technology. It will also focus
on how the industry positively impacts society. This is where Intel's made significant investments and impacts over the years. 4 years ago, on the stage at CES, I talked to you about conflict minerals. And after careful researching about where our minerals were coming from, we committed to use only conflict-free minerals in our microprocessors. Now, through further effort with third parties and direct validations by our supply chain, we've gone well beyond microprocessors to ensure that every product is labeled conflict-free. Three years ago, we took a hard look at the data about women and underrepresented minorities in the technology industry, and we knew change was needed. In 2015, we set a goal to invest $300 million over 5 years to improve diversity in our workplace. And I'm pleased to share with you that we've had great success. We've increased the diversity of Intel's U.S. workforce, and we'll reach our full representation by the end of 2018, a full 2 years earlier than we committed. And that's a major milestone for the industry. We'll continue to publish our data on a regular basis to prioritize diversity and inclusion, allowing Intel employees to be part of a culture that positively impacts society. Now, there's a next area that we believe we can go and impact society, and that's in safety and transportation. It's not an exaggeration to say that the rise of autonomous cars will be the most ambitious data project of our lifetime. It's significant and will reshape our cities, our transportation systems, and beyond that, it'll be one of the most positive social forces technology has ever unleashed, because it's going to save lives. Autonomous driving studies estimate that over 1.25 million lives could be saved as a result of fewer fatal car accidents. Over 157 hours of commute time can be saved per person every year through autonomous vehicles. And over $150 billion in fuel costs can be saved in the U.S. economy over the course of a single year. As you can see, the impacts will be enormous. We want to push this technology even further. We want to build a platform that allows autonomous cars to become a reality, from commercial fleets to passenger cars everywhere on the road. This isn't just an experiment, it's a path to the future. It's not just the technology, it's about the safety as well. So to help us understand why I believe autonomous vehicles are closer to reality than anyone realizes, let me introduce one of the world's great entrepreneurs and an expert in autonomous driving, the co-founder of Mobileye, Professor Amnon Shashua. Welcome to CES, Amnon, a great entry.
Thanks, Brian, it's great to be here.
So, I saw no hands on the wheels, but this doesn't look like the traditional autonomous car. There's no big LiDAR on top. It just looks a little bit cleaner and smoother.
Well, first, I'm proud to introduce one of our first vehicles out of a fleet of 100 cars that we announced last year. And indeed, as you said, all the sensors are very discreet, unlike what you normally see in the media.
So, last year, we had the pleasure of welcoming Mobileye to the Intel family. We believe Mobileye has developed the most powerful technology for autonomous vehicles, including this car you arrived in.
Mobileye is proud to be part of Intel, and we are excited to be working together on building a world of safer cars.
Yeah, so I think this audience would be interested a little bit in understanding how exactly the Mobileye technology can lead us to a safer future with fewer accidents and how you really see it playing out.
Well, it starts with sensors. We have cameras, about 12 cameras around the car. We have a cocoon of radars and laser scanners, LIDARs, all fed into high-performance computing system on chips from Mobileye and an Atom architecture by Intel. So when we talk about cameras, we have three cameras in front, three different fields of view, which gives you about 180 degrees in total, and very high resolution. So you can see about 250, 300 meters range. We have cameras, wing cameras and side cameras that give you half a sphere on the side, a rear camera, and then four parking cameras, altogether 12 cameras, and then radars and ladders for redundancy. And I think we'll say bye-bye to Yaman. Thank you. So the social cost of road accidents is just too great, and we believe building trust between our consumers and the vehicles is critical. So we have identified four areas that we are addressing to make autonomous vehicle real. First is sensing, and that includes all the high-performance computing. Then mapping, driving policy, which is about planning decisions and merging into traffic. And then models that provide safety guarantees, which are coordinated with government regulations.
Okay, so let's start with sensing, since that's like really the root of these cars. I have this great visual of a car behind us. Can you help us understand what role Mobileye plays in the sensors?
Well, let's start with today. Today, Mobileye system on chip and software powers driving assist cameras on over 24 million cars. So 9 million of them installed during 2017. Now, we had 30 design wins with 27 car makers during 2017, and we'll be launching 15 production programs in 2018. So most likely, if you're driving a vehicle equipped, if you're driving a vehicle, it's equipped with Mobileye, and this is real reality. And our technology enables driving assist functions such as automatic emergency braking, lane keeping support, traffic sign recognition, and much more. And we are in many different car brands on the road. This includes Ford, GM, Audi, BMW, Honda, Nissan, Hyundai, and many more.
Okay, so can we talk about how this all works? And so I've got the sensors now. How does it really come together?
Well, there are three pieces. So in the car that you have just seen, you have an architecture of computing that processes the raw sensor signals and creates an environmental model with every detail around the car. So we're talking about road users, objects, and drivable paths. Then we have massively advanced driving policy software and using reinforcement learning that makes decisions of driving maneuvers that are, and including assertive ones, and providing safety guarantees together. Into this mix comes also high definition maps, which creates further redundancy and foresight of drivable paths to make sure that nothing of value is missed by the system.
So I think you and I are big advocates of this technology. How fast do you think this is advancing? What's the rate of advancement here?
Well, actually, very rapidly. We are developing faster processing chips and superior software, and the very best architecture combining Mobileye's IQ system on chips and Intel's Atom architecture. To be more specific, in a few months, we are sampling our fifth generation system on chip, the IQ5, that is expected to run 24 tera operations per second at an extremely low power of 10 watts. Raw computing density is important. That's the 24 tera ops. Diversity of cores is also important in order to run different workloads. But power is crucial.
Right.
You know, this machine needs to fit in a car, most likely powered by a battery. So every watt counts.
So that 24 tera ops at 10 watts is an important set of parameters.
It's not only important, it's the best on the planet. And you know, the industry knows that we're pushing the boundaries. In addition to our level four partners, BMW, Fiat Chrysler, Aptiv, NIO, our latest addition to build together a level four fully autonomous car is SAIC Motor, the largest automaker in China.
So you've told us about the sensing, but you know, one of the real breakthroughs that you and I have talked about is in the mapping. And after all, mapping is that data That's so important. So can you tell us how you see that all coming together with Mobileye?
Well, first, when we say mapping, we're not talking about the conventional navigation maps that we are all familiar with. We're talking about maps that are required for supporting autonomous driving, and they require levels of details you cannot find in navigation maps. And creating these high-definition maps is a big logistical problem. Even more difficult is keeping these maps updated in real time. And we believe that crowdsourcing is the only solution. And this is possible because Mobileye has both the crowd. We have tens of millions of cameras on cars. And we have a technical solution capable of compressing the data small enough to communicate over wireless networks. We're talking about 10 kilobytes per kilometer, which is really nothing. So cars equipped with Mobileye cameras and chip act as data collectors, as harvesters, and build continuously update the high-definition maps. And we call this data collection Road Experience Management, or REM. Let's take a look at how it works in the following clip. So what you see here on the left display, you see map data, these colored lines projected onto the image frame. And these lines are sitting exactly on real lane marks on the road. So I guess this gives you a sense of accuracy. We're talking about accuracies at the level of centimeters. On the right display, you see the same information but projected on Google Earth, again, to give you a sense of accuracy. And accuracy comes from the accuracy of the map data itself, but also accuracy of localization. The system in real time localizes the car inside the map. So crowdsourcing is the most affordable way to create real-time, up-to-date, and accurate maps. And the industry is on board. We have production programs this year launching from BMW, Nissan, and Volkswagen. They'll be equipped with REM and begin crowdsourcing and updating the REM map in 2018. We have global mapping is advancing rapidly and one of the most exciting areas of autonomous driving. We are announcing today two new mapping partnerships in China with SAIC and also NavInfo. And with these new relationships, REM is in every major market.
So, you know, you and I have been big advocates and believe in this technology. And the critical piece will be getting the regulators and the local governments to really help us make this a reality as well, correct?
Well, I agree, Brian. We are embarking on the most ambitious and comprehensive plan to formalize the common sense of human judgment of driving, and create a model of safety we call RSS, that together with regulatory bodies will make autonomous vehicles a reality. And this week, we'll host conversations on precisely this topic. There's a lot of interest, and I hope you join us.
Okay, so where do we go from here?
Well, I think it is time for you to take a tour in our technology and take it out on the roads. And the car that you have just seen is yours, and you'll start driving with it from home to work.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
So, just so you know, that's not just hype. The idea is, that is my car. They're going to finish it up over the next couple of months. And it is while I'll be driving to work in the Bay Area. And I'll invite press along at times to come to work with me and experience what it's like to drive an autonomous vehicle like this. Now, let's think beyond autonomous cars. This one's going to surprise you guys a bit. 55 years ago, the TV show The Jetsons first aired and showed us a future where flying cars were a part of everyday life. And we're on the cusp of making that a reality. Volocopter is at the leading edge of this technology. It's essentially a flying car. It was conceived, designed, and engineered to be one of the first autonomous air taxis. Imagine pulling out your phone, opening up a transportation app, and summoning your own personalized ride by air taxi. And that sci-fi vision of the future is actually much closer than you may think. The intersection of innovation where autonomous cars meet autonomous flying machines is once again data. The underlying technology to make this future a reality already exists today. Mm-hmm. was fantastic. That was the best flight I've ever had. Everybody will fly one of these someday. It truly was an incredible ride. I can tell you it was the smoothest, funnest ride I've ever had or experienced. So to tell you a little bit more about the Volocopter and the future of urban mobility, please welcome on stage here at CES, the CEO of Volocopter, Florian Reuter. Hey, Florian. So, hey, can you tell the audience a little bit about the Volocopter and your plans to truly make it a reality?
Absolutely, Brian. Happy to tell more. So, the Volocopter is an entirely novel type of vertical takeoff and landing aircraft. It offers unprecedented levels of safety, is extremely simple to fly, quiet, and when running on its batteries, emission-free. It is not some distant sci-fi fantasy. The Volocopter is real and already exists today, as you just saw in the video.
I can attest to that.
As the pioneers in the space, we have collected hundreds of flights, flying practically every day back at our base in Germany. Early in 2016, we conducted the first ever manned flight outdoors with the Volocopter, participating in the airspace based on an official permit to fly from German aviation authorities. Now, that achievement was a true milestone in aviation history. We hit yet another milestone about 4 months ago when conducting the first ever flight of an autonomous air taxi in the city of Dubai. And I can tell you, there were numerous approval authorities involved in approving that stunt. Now, soon we will offer autonomous air taxi flights as a service in cities across the world, revolutionizing the way we all experience urban mobility today. And the best about it, it has the potential to be affordable for all of us.
Yeah, no, I agree. And that Volocopter uses the safe flight control technology that the Falcon 8 Plus drone that Intel makes uses for inspections and surveys and mapping. So it's got a lot of other uses and reliability testing. So, but why do you think autonomous air taxis are going to be adopted by consumers? What's going to drive this to people?
Well, who wouldn't like to fly across city, sit in the Volocopter, look at it from an entirely new perspective, skip traffic, save time? So, to fly drones at this scale, what we need are batteries with very high energy density. And also, we need the capability of processing vast amounts of data in milliseconds, especially when flying autonomously. And that is where you come into play. So, with Intel inside, tech is now able to perform this task because it is powerful, small, and lightweight.
This is great, Florian. What I would really love to be able to do is show the audience what a Volocopter really looks like.
That will be great. And of course, we can do it. So, when flying a full-scale Volocopter, sorry, skipped it. You know what? We thought CES is the perfect opportunity to bring Volocopter to North America for the very first time. So check it out.
Okay. They want to see it fly. Don't you?
Okay, we'll make it happen. As I already started, you know, flying a Volocopter inside the theater, live on stage, does come along with some challenges. So, in order to pull off that stunt, we had to put some safety measures in place. But I'm confident you will still be able to enjoy it and get a feel for it.
Okay, let's let it fly. Okay, that was awesome. It's quiet, it's fast, it's efficient, it's safe, and people can visit the Volocopter on display in the central plaza at the Las Vegas Convention Center throughout CES. It's right across the street from the Intel booth.
That's right. So you're all invited to stop by and get an up-close and personal look at the Volocopter.
Well, I really want to thank you. I think this is definitely the first time anything that big has flown, either on this stage, but probably at CES as well. Thanks for showing us the future for you. I told you guys would like that one, but we have more. At Intel, we see truly a world of infinite possibilities, where technology makes our lives easier. We see a future where technology makes the world a better place. I'm not saying it's going to be easy or simple, but we must be diligent and thoughtful. We have to consider how new technologies impact not only the people who embrace, but also the people who don't embrace them. As we've seen here tonight, almost every one of those technologies is enabled by data. Whether they're big ideas like autonomous driving, artificial intelligence, the Volocopter, but they can also be small ones. I'd like to introduce to you our newest drone, the Intel Shooting Star Mini. Everything it does is made simple and possible by data. Now, this is not the type of drone you can buy in a store. The hardware is a completely new design, so it can be safely flown and navigate indoors where there is no GPS. It has the most advanced software and is fully automated. And a single fleet of 100 drones can be controlled by one pilot.
Stargazing, I still look up, look up.
I really hope you enjoyed the new member of our family. This is a show that a lot of engineers have been working on. But what you also probably don't know is you just witnessed an official Guinness World Record. The world's first 100 drone indoor flight show without GPS. For more original Shooting Star drone light shows, please join us tonight at 9 p.m. outside at the Bellagio Fountains, and again at 11 p.m., now weather permitting. I never thought it rained in Vegas. You can also catch more planned shows at the Bellagio Fountains Tuesday through Thursday at 8 and 10 p.m. I really want to thank you for joining me tonight to take a glimpse into the future of technology. Have a wonderful evening and enjoy CES 2018.